So the agenda today would be, we would look at why an organization would move away from a siloed architecture. And we will briefly look at what is services-oriented architecture and what benefits that it can bring to your organization. How to expand your horizons with services-oriented architecture using APIs. We will look at what is SOA and its differences with what is SOA and how it compares with microservices architecture. And then finally, we look at how you can transition to a services-oriented architecture. So we'll start with looking at what are system silos. So system silos are mostly monolithic systems, which are large in size, which are hard to change, which doesn't change often. They are isolated and independent. Mostly these systems work in isolation, doesn't talk to any other systems, or rarely talks to any other systems within your organization. They are built to solve a specific requirement of a segment, mostly a requirement of a different department within your organization. And there's no standard way of communication between the systems. So there are no standard interfaces exposed. There are no standard protocols available to communicate within these systems. So what problems does this kind of architecture brings in? The primary problem is that it is difficult to integrate with other systems. So since there are no standard way of or standard interface to do this, it is difficult for you to integrate a single silo with another silo. If you take this particular example, you may have a ERP, a HR, finance, and a CRM system. So it is difficult to integrate operations of each of these systems using a standard way. There can be duplication of processes. So if you take something like a billing process, which may be replicated or repeated in your ERP system, it can be in your CRM and the finance system, but they ideally they would be doing the same kind of work. So there's no way for you to have or reuse these kind of commonly used processes within silos that you have inside your organization. It is expensive to maintain, given that you have an entire system. So if you want to do a change to your system, you need to go through the entire code base, redo the change, build everything together. So it's kind of expensive to maintain, and it is less scalable. So if you want to scale a system like your ERP, you need to have another instance of the ERP system. So rather than scaling a given service or a module, you need to do the entire system and then scale it up. And it is slow to adopt change. So if you want to do a change, you have to go through the entire code base, do the change. That process will take time, and it increases the time to market and reduces your ability to change your system as the business requires. So at the bottom line, this kind of architecture doesn't suit the modern enterprise landscape. So what is services-oriented architecture and what benefits does it bring into the system? A services-oriented architecture is an architecture pattern where systems provide services to other systems using standard protocols that are used for communication. Services-oriented architecture is primarily product, vendor, and technology independent. The boundaries of these systems are explicitly defined. So when you want to talk from one system to another, there's a standard interface that is available. And then you use that interface to talk to the other system. There are no back-channel calls. There are no hidden classes that you can invoke. So everything is explicitly defined, and you need to follow that particular standard. Services are autonomous, which means that service has the flexibility, the runtime of the service has the flexibility to do whatever it requires as long as it doesn't impact the service interface. So if there is a change or an impact that will happen to the service interface, a new contract can be shared with your service consumers, and this new version of the service can be communicated to your service consumers. So everything goes through a proper process to make sure that your consumers are not affected by any changes that happens in the service interface. Services share schemas and contracts, not classes. It is very important. So if you take a service-oriented architecture, they have a properly defined visitor, which a consumer can come in and see. They can come in and see what are the services available, what are the methods available, and make the service call accordingly. Finally, everything is driven by policies. What it means by policies is that if you take a service, it may have functional and non-functional requirements. Functional requirements will define what the service should do, and the non-functional requirements would define how the service is exposed to your consumers. So if you take a service, it can have a it can be exposed to HTTP clients, it can be used to, it can be exposed to your JMS consumers. So the policy will define how it is exposed rather than it is being embedded in the service implementation itself. So moving on to my next slide, why services-oriented architecture? Services-oriented architecture promotes loose coupling. So idea behind it is that you break down a monolithic system into smaller services and expose these services to other components within the organization. It is easy to maintain. Given that services are broken down into smaller components, it is easy to do changes, troubleshoot these services. Given that you have services available, they can be reused by other components within the organization. So if we go back to the billing example, you may have a billing service that can be used by your CRM system, that can be used by your ERP system, and any other system that needs the service of this particular component. It improves the flexibility, so you don't have to be language specific, so you can have certain systems developed in Java, certain systems in .NET, some systems in PHP or Python. As long as you expose these services as a standard, through a standard services layer, the language is not important. And components written in different languages can talk to each other through the services layer. It provides agility. So, for example, if you want to create a new service or a new business system, so you can reuse the components that are available and build a system at a faster rate. So, reduce the time to market. So, whenever your business analysts require a given system to be implemented, you can quickly do this using existing services and write services that can fill in the gaps and then make it available for your business entities. So services-oriented architecture also creates new business opportunities. You can expose your services to your service consumers, your partners, your suppliers, who can come in and consume these services through a standard set of protocols or standard set of APIs that are exposed from your organization. So to talk a bit about SOA in real world, SOA creates certain, you need to be aware of certain things when moving to a services-oriented architecture. It can create complex point-to-point integrations. As you could see in this diagram, which was referred several times during our conference, so this is an example of how the integration could look like in an organization. It creates security and access management concerns. Given that you have services talking to each other, you need to secure these services to make sure that services are accessed by authorized applications and authorized service consumers, and there are no back channels or people using these services to do certain tasks that are not authorized by the system. Thirdly, it is important to manage service components. So you need to version the services accordingly. So you need to have a mechanism to expose your services, version them, and then manage them accordingly so that someone who wants to write a new component or new system can make use of these services that are available. Given the nature of the services-oriented architecture, you may have to think about reliable communication. You need to make sure that the messages are communicated between services in a reliable manner. There won't be any message drops for critical kind of communication that happens between these systems. And finally, you may have to monitor the usage of the system to make sure that the systems are used correctly, and then there's no to identify what systems or what services that needs to be scaled and so on. So ideally, SOA isn't all about loose coupling. So that's a concern. That's something that you need to keep in mind. So if you take this particular analogy, you could see services, loose coupling is just the tip of the iceberg. There's a lot more things that you need to be concerned when moving or adopting a services-oriented architecture. Primary concern is to reduce point-to-point integration through the use of patterns like the integration bus pattern. So that all services talk to a common integration bus layer, and then all the messages will flow through this integration bus. It is important to secure the messages that are communicated between services. So you need to implement certain message security mechanisms to secure the messages at the message layer. At the same time, you need to make sure that your services are secured so that access to a given service can be controlled using an identity and access management tool. It is important for you to manage components through a registry and a repository. So you should ideally have a mechanism to record all the services that are available, to manage the lifecycle of these services, and then version these services and make it available for a host of different service consumers who can come in and discover the services. And then message persistence should be implemented through use of a message broker, so that all the critical messages that flow through the system can be stored in case of a failure and then redelivered at a later time when required. It is important to analyze the usage of components. So you need to make sure that you analyze which services are in demand so that you can identify which services that needs to be scaled. The usage can be analyzed using analytics tool, where you can pump in all the data from different services that you have in your system. So this diagram looks at the transition to services-oriented architecture. So if you see the pre-SOA monolithic kind of an architecture, everything is coupled together, tightly coupled, and everything works in a confined environment. And when you move to traditional SOA, you will see the components or the services are scattered out, and they are communicating with each other using standard protocols and communication mechanisms available. So this is a reference architecture of how to implement services-oriented architecture using WS2 products. So as you could see here, there's a if I start from the bottom, there's an infrastructure layer, and on top of it you have your services layer, which can be hosted on a application hosting product like the WS2 application server. Then you have the data layer, which hosts all the data within your organization. They can be visualized, they can be virtualized using the data services server. And then you may have your cloud services that are available that you need to expose or that you need to integrate with your existing architecture. So you have a message persistence layer which sits on top of the application and the data services layer to provide message persistence. And on top of everything, there is the enterprise integration bus, which is the primary component in the integration layer. Enterprise integration bus provides a capability for you to support a messaging bus kind of architecture, where all the system components that are in the services layer can be linked to the enterprise service bus. For long-running processes, there is a business process server, which can support, which can manage the long-running processes that are available in your system. And security requirements, governance requirements, and monitoring requirements of the entire architecture can be supported by the governance registry, the identity server, and the data analytics server, which can provide the capability across the platform to manage your services. So in this slide, we will look at how you can expand the boundaries of services-oriented architecture by exposing these services as APIs for consumption. The primary objective of this is to open organizations' boundaries to outside for your customers, your partners, as well as your suppliers as APIs who can come in and consume these services that are available within the organization. So you have the ability to innovatively deliver existing business capabilities for your service consumers. This can also bring in new businesses and drive more revenue for your organization. And it also can streamline operations for internal and external entities within and outside your organization. So if you look at how the API management layer sits in the picture, API management layer will be on top of the enterprise, on top of the integration layer, which will expose the services that are available in the integration layer through an API management layer to your service consumers. They can be coming as customer applications, they can be partners, they can be your internal applications, they can be your suppliers. All of them can access this API management layer, which provides the capability to expose, secure, and manage APIs that are available within your organization. So let's look at what is beyond services-oriented architecture. So as you could see the timeline, in early 90s, we talked about monolithic systems. And in early 2000s, we looked at traditional services-oriented architecture. And by 2010, we were talking about microservices, which is a more decoupled kind of architecture, moving more to a fine-grained implementation of services-oriented architecture. So what's the relationship between services-oriented architecture and microservices? So microservices is essentially an extension to the services-oriented architecture. Microservices provide a restful, lean, and fine-grained way of implementing services. Services can be deployed on containers, and then these containers can be, the advantage of having everything in a container would be that you don't need a guest OS available within the container, and that allows better resource usage, so that you optimize the usage of the available resources within the organization. And given the container nature, or given the microservices nature, you can scale your services in a better fashion. And then it is it is easy to maintain, basically, where if you want to do a change, or if you want to troubleshoot something within a microservice, it is easy to do, rather than you do it at a more larger scale in a traditional services-oriented architecture, or a monolithic system that has everything together. So if you look at this diagram, this is an extension of what I've discussed earlier. So if you see the services layer, and when you move into microservices, you will replace it with a microservices kind of microservices hosting environment. So WSO2 provides microservices framework for Java for this purpose. So it's a framework that allows you to create microservices, and then it's based on JAX-RS and uses most of the JAX-RS annotations that are available. So finally, how would you transition to a services-oriented architecture? So it is important for you to build on existing services rather than dropping or rather than throwing everything that you everything out that you already have. You can build on whatever that you already have, and then create, then move into services-oriented architecture. You need to redesign services to be more generic and reusable, by which a service can be used. A service should be designed so that it can be used by not only for the primary purpose, but also by other components which may need to access this particular service. Ideal example is the billing system that I talked about earlier. So if you design your billing system to be more generic, it can be used not only by your CRM, but also by your finance system and the ERP system to carry out a certain task. Focus on scope rather than size. So breaking down services doesn't mean that you need to break down into equal sizes. You need to focus on the scope. Ideally, a service needs to contain, a service has to have a defined scope. It can have a large size or a smaller size. It can do a few couple of operations, or it can do entire operations of a large system. However, the scope should be the primary concern when breaking down a service. It is important to avoid vendor lock-in. You should architect the solution based on your requirement, but not based on what is available by a given vendor. So it is very important for you to have a vendor neutral view of your architecture, and then select a vendor who provides the best suite of products that can fulfill your requirements. It is important to improve service discoverability and encourage usage. So your services should be discoverable by different entities within an organization. You may end up having hundreds of services, and if they're not discoverable, no one's going to reuse those services. So you need to make sure that your services are discoverable and can be reused by others within the organization. And essentially, make it future-proof so that your architecture will remain for a couple of years or 5 to 10 years based on how you are going to design it, and then work be available for you in the long term as well.